Hey, this is His Word Unveiled. I'm excited. I so hope that you are too. No particular reason for this excitement. It's just another day that we get to dive into the Word of God. This stuff means something. Like, this is beautiful. When the Lord calls us to do something and we're just walking in obedience, we're just seeking Him. The weight is completely off of us. There's not any of this heaviness. We're just listening. We're just obeying, and we're letting God have His way. We're letting God do His thing. This is all Him. This is all Him. I love the way He desires to work in us. In my weakness and in the things that I don't know and I don't see and I don't do so well, I'm just in this obeying. And God's moving and God's teaching. And I just pray that He is meeting with you in such an intimate way as He is meeting with me, as He is showing up every time I go to seek Him. I'm pursuing Him. And in your pursuit, I truly just pray that He is overwhelming you with this newness, with this just depth of relationship with Him and connection to Him. So, okay, let's get into our reading. Excited for today. Matthew chapter 6 and 7 is what we're hitting. So two chapters. If you've been watching these videos, you know what's coming next. I'm going to tell you to get away with the Lord in such stillness and such purpose and just read through these chapters. Be intentional. Take your time in them. Let God show up. Because here's the thing. This is why this is so important. God sees you. God knows you. Therefore, God is the only one who's going to speak into your heart in such a way that will change your life. No one else can do that. People may be able to inspire you or challenge you to do things, but only God can come in and change you, transform you, heal you. That's God. This is God alone. And this ministry is just laying a foundation to learn to put into practice just meeting with Him, being so purposeful in those moments that we meet with Him, giving Him just the freedom to come and do whatever, to show up, to invade, to stir things up, to shift things around, to clean up. This is just us saying, okay, God, we're being serious about this and we want you to meet with us. We want more of you. I want so much more of the Lord. There's so much that I don't understand and see, and I just want more. I want to discover more of the Lord. I want to discover more of my King. I just want more. And this ministry has seriously just ushered me in to that kind of more. And I just want more and more, even more. So let's do it. You get away with the Lord and go after more. Just go get more. Just let Him pour out more into you. Let Him speak to you in a way that no one else can. So in such a personal way, in such an intimate way, I'm excited for you. I'm excited for me. I'm going to pray and we're going to get this thing started. So whenever you're done reading and spending that time with the Lord, hop back on here, hit play, and we'll walk this through together. Lord, we give this time to you. We just praise you. I'm so excited. Thank you for just being the excitement within me and the joy within me. Lord, thank you for just desiring to work in us and choosing to just meet us. Lord, you are a holy God, and to just choose to be with us in such a personal way, a holy God, yet choosing to come down with us and just in a personal way, meeting with us and speaking to us and helping us see and grow and learn. And thank you. Thank you, Father, for just thinking of us, for being with us. Thank you. Lord, we just want more of you. Take us deeper. Please take us deeper today. I want to see and discover more of your heart. I just want more of who you are. Have your way, Lord. It's got to be you. It's only you. It's got to be your movement and your just stirring things up. It's you. It's all in you. It's your glory. It's connection with and in and to you. Lord, we love you. I love your heart. And I just want more and more of it. Father, thank you for being who you are. Thank you for being here now with us. I'm so excited for how you're going to walk us through more of your truth, more of your word, and deeper into your heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Matthew chapter 6. Okay, wow, this was a game changer for me, chapter 6, truly was. So verses 1 through 18, pretty legit. Seriously, game changer for me personally. Right at the beginning, the Lord says, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before men, to be noticed by them." Now, practicing your righteousness before men, this is not the struggle. This is not the thing we're commanded not to do. We are to practice our righteousness before everyone. We are to practice our righteousness in every situation, behind closed doors, when we're in a whole group of people, when we're at work, practicing our righteousness is just what we are to do, that constant seeking the Lord and that constant pursuit, that constant practicing, that constant rehearsing, that constant renewing our minds, that constant purifying our hearts, that constant evaluating and walking through and standing on His truth and remembering scriptures. It's like an everyday, there's no breaking in that. There shouldn't be a break in that. Throughout our whole day, we should be reflecting on who God is, on what He's called us to do, on His truth, on what He's done, on what He can do. Those things, we are to be practicing our righteousness before men. But what we are commanded to do in verse 1 is not to practice our righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Otherwise, you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. Now, we need to be practicing. We need to be living our lives solely focused on the Lord, going after Him. In that, we can't get distracted in making sure that other people notice, that other people are aware, that other people know, that other people understand all we're doing and how well we're doing, and it should never be. The Lord calls us to do these things in a personal way. Just like at the beginning, just like in my prayer, it's He works intimately, individually, meeting us, making sure that it's real, that it doesn't just happen when it's around a group of people. That these connections, these encounters with the Lord, they're not just happening when we're at these big events, when we're with a whole group of people who have similar views. No, God says these things should happen, these encounters with the Lord, this our pursuit of God should happen all the time, no matter what, and for one goal, and that is to know the Lord, not to lift ourselves up, not for other people to see what we're doing, not to receive credit, not to receive glory and honor, not for people to look at us and say, oh my word, you're so wonderful, you're so great, you can do this and that and all of this, not to be noticed by men. And that first word, beware, this just, it doesn't say don't do it, it says beware of doing it. Otherwise, you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. Because if we are seeking out rewards, if we are seeking out glory from people here, men and women here around us, if we're seeking out that glory, then if we receive that glory, that's all the glory we get. It says, otherwise you will have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. That it's a one-time glory kind of thing from one person. We're either seeking glory from the Lord, we're either seeking to be found in His glory with Him, connected to Him, or we are seeking out glory from men and women around us. It's one or the other. And if we're seeking it from the Lord, then we have blessings and rewards now of His peace and His presence, and we will have rewards for us in heaven. And that reward being that we're going to be with Him, living with our Savior forever in eternity. That's our reward. But if we're getting it here from men and women, that's all we get. That's our reward. That's it. There's no reward for us with our Father who is in heaven if we're seeking the glory of men and women here. Now, this whole concept goes in deeper and deeper in verse 2. So when you give to the poor, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be honored by men. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. But when you give to the poor, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving will be in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So it's this whole hidden concept. Going back to Psalms 139, where the Lord says, I made you in secret, in that secret place, that word sefer, where we were hidden, where we were created to be protected and covered, hidden with just Him. There was no one else around. The Lord didn't call so many people to observe, to watch, to cheer, to celebrate. It was you and the Lord. That He created you in that secret place, being hidden, protected, covered by Him. That is beautiful. And that is the concept here, that the Lord said, if I created you that way to be hidden in me, then I want you to live hidden in me. The world does not need to know what we're doing and see all that we're doing, see all this, these good ways that we're giving and helping and serving and in ministries and how we're doing and all this stuff. We shouldn't have this need to tell the world. We shouldn't have this need for them to see how well we're doing. When we are pushing for that and we're striving for that, then it strips all the authenticity out of it. It strips it all. That we're doing it for one reason, and that's then to receive glory from men. to be seen by men, but the Lord calls us into this authentic way of living, this real way of living. And it's real when it's done when no one is watching. It's real when it's done when we simply just have our eyes on the Lord. We're not concerned with what anybody sees, with what anybody's thinking, with how anybody feels or how they think about it. When that's out, when that's not in the forefront of our mind at all, when it's nowhere, and we're just focused on the Lord, then it's real. It's real because we're just doing it to know God. That's when it's real. That's when it holds purpose. That's when it gets somewhere. It goes somewhere. And that's when our reward is real as well. It says so that your giving will be in secret, that we don't need to announce it. What we do to glorify the Lord, and that's it. That's it. And it says, and your Father who sees what is done in secret, because he sees us. He sees us. We don't have to be desperate to be seen. We are seen. We don't have to be striving to be loved. We are loved. We don't have to freak out about people not understanding, and we have to clear this up. God understands us. That's the calmness. That's the peace and the rest that we can live in when we're just focused on glorifying the Lord, knowing that he sees us. Your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. The same concept starts in verse 5 about prayer. When you pray, you are not to be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on the street corners so that they may be seen by men. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. So by other people seeing them, acknowledging them, thinking, oh, look how spiritual they are, that's their reward. That's all they get. When that's what they're seeking after, when that's what they're striving, that's what they get. That's their reward. That's all it is. But when we are seeking the Lord, then that's all we get. That's we get all of that. We get all of God and all that comes with him. All of that God goodness, all that godness, all of that blessing, all of that peace, all of that freedom. Like, do we get that? What we seek after, God doesn't force blessings upon us. We spoke that a lot throughout the Old Testament. God doesn't force blessings upon us. He doesn't. He gives us what we want. He really does. And if we're choosing life without the Lord and we're constantly turning away from him and going after other things, he is not going to rope us and pull us back. He won't. He's a gentleman. He doesn't force anything. He allows us to choose. He gives everything. He pours out everything. He offers himself in absolute fullness, but he lets us choose. And whatever it is that we are choosing to pursue, that is what we will have. If we're choosing to pursue a life of glory and honor for us, that's what we're going to go after. Then when we get that, that's our reward. That's what it is. That's what we went after. That's what we receive. Done deal. But goodness gracious, when our pursuit is going after the Lord, when we seek the Lord, when we're going after him, then goodness, what that reward is. What that is, that those rewards, those blessings, they come now, here and now. It may not appear that way to men, but it's here and now that we live a life with real peace, with real growth, we're in real purpose, real things are happening. And not only that, but we have rewards then with our Father in heaven, waiting for us, that we have the opportunity to live in eternity with him. So that's where it's at. That is absolutely beautiful, but it's all done in secret. It's all done hidden in the Lord, not for other people to see. It doesn't matter. Who cares if people think something about us or don't know something about us or think that we're not super close with the Lord or think this about us? It doesn't matter. What does that have to do with anything? How will that change anything about what God says about me, about my honest pursuit with the Lord? It doesn't matter. We can't be so consumed with the world seeing and noticing and acknowledging and giving us credit and honor and all of this. It's got to be done hidden in the Lord. That's when things happen. Verse 6 continues with that. But you, when you pray, go into your inner room, close your door, and pray to your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition as the Gentiles do, for they suppose that they will be heard for their many words. So using these eloquent words and speaking these typical prayers of just laying out in such, you know, just so much religion in it, so much just customs, practices, making sure that it sounds right, it sounds great. God just wants those broken prayers. God just wants those vulnerable ones. God just wants that authentic praise, that heartfelt cry out, God, you are good. God, I need you. God, I praise you. God, I trust you. God, I love you. Those kind of prayers are what God is after. And those are real when we're not concerned about how they sound in front of anybody else. We've got to block everything else out, and just get where it's you and Father, where it's you and Him, just alone, just together. Even when you're in a group of people, a whole crowd of people, we've got to get to the point where we don't know a single other person is in the room, where it's just you and the Lord. That again is when things happen. Okay, verse 8. So do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. Pray then in this way: Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. So right away, with this example of a prayer, Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name, lifting the Lord up, glorifying Him, acknowledging who He is right away. Your kingdom come, your will be done. This is about the Lord. You being here, present with us, us aware, us acknowledging that your will be done, whatever you want, have your way, those kind of prayers. On earth as it is in heaven, making this connection, being aligned with the Lord, with His truth, with just understanding the spiritual realm and being so in tune, so guarded, the full armor of God on, praying with all we are, seeking with all of our heart. In this, verse 11, give us this day our daily bread. So seeking the Lord for all provision, that we don't need a single thing, that His grace is sufficient for us, that He will provide every day for us, meeting us, seeing our need, meeting us right where we're at. Verse 12, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. Again, this whole understanding of forgiving, going to the Lord in this and seeking in repentance and humility, understanding our need for the Lord, how desperate we are for God. Verse 13, and do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Praying that protection, praying that guarding, going to the Lord as our deliverer, as our defender, as the one who will cover, who does cover and protect us. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Lifting the Lord up again, beginning off and just glorifying Him, ending with, God, you are all powerful. All authority is given to you. You've got everything in your hands. You can do anything. You're fully capable. We look to you. We trust you. We love you. And all of that in those type of prayers, and throwing in everything personal, everything real, everything that applies, just the simple practical things of our day, and seeking the Lord in and like that. Verse 14, for if you forgive others for their transgressions, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others, then your Father will not forgive your transgressions. So pushing this in, we've got to forgive. We've got to be open. Again, not concerned, not holding all of this, not so focused and concerned on what's going on with the people around us and the people in our lives. What are they thinking? What have they done to us? What do we deserve? They're not that nice. They've done this to me. All of these things, let it go. We've got to forgive. We've got to say all this stuff around, what they do, what things are said, what things are going on, it doesn't matter. The only thing that matters is a relationship with the Lord. The things that matter, we have to be eternally minded in everything we do, and seeking the Lord and receiving His forgiveness. Therefore, in the measure that the Lord forgives us, we should be able to forgive, to just let that go, to know that release. Because when we start really looking at even our last chapter that we hit, the seriousness of our sin, that last video in Matthew 5, the seriousness of our sin, we come to understand how pretty pathetic we are, how often we sin, how much we mess up, how our minds just so easily go astray, how we grow content, how we get grumbly, how we, all of these things, and understanding that God, in His grace and in His mercy, He forgives time and time again. As we seek Him, as we choose humility and repentance, He forgives every time. And we have to have that kind of heart. We have to have that kind of passion and perspective for other people and what matters, that we see them as not people who've hurt us or who've offended us or have done these things to us, but they are souls. They are souls whom Jesus loves, who Jesus came to save, to be in the presence of. This is huge, and that should change us, understanding the significance and the power of God's grace that He pours upon our lives. We should be so focused on the Lord that just in the way we live and the way that we are close to the Lord's heart, it should shape us to naturally just move out and love others, forgive others, let this stuff go, and really focus down and only focus in on the things that matter, not getting caught up of the things of the world, the things of the flesh, the things that the enemy wants us distracted in and by. Verse 15, this continues on this forgiving. But if you do not forgive others, then your Father will not forgive your transgressions. Whenever you fast, do not put on a gloomy face as the hypocrites do, for they neglect their appearance so that they will be noticed by men when they are fasting. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. So just like giving, just like praying, now we're hitting fasting, where it says when they're fasting, they make themselves look really tired and wore out so that they can express to people, oh yeah, this is really hard, but I'm fasting and I'm doing what, you know, I'm doing what is right and I'm being really religious. They're so just self-righteous in this and wanting people to see that, hey, they're fasting. Wanting people to see that, hey, they're being just really close to God and they're doing all of these things. When the Lord again says, when people notice, and all the people that they speak this to and let them know that they're being super righteous and religious and doing these things, Jesus again says, that's their reward. That's their reward in full. That's all they get. If that's what they're after, that's what they're going to get. That's what they're going to receive. They're not interested in the favor of God. They're not interested in the Lord seeing and loving and being pleased and pouring just glory, filling them up with glory. They're not concerned with that. The only thing they're bogging themselves down with is that other men see them, that other men know how righteous they are, and that's their reward in full. And what we miss out on, the blessings we miss out on when we strive for that attention from men, when we strive for that acknowledgement. Verse 17, but you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face so that your fasting will not be noticed by men, but your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Again, those rewards, that glory that God sees, that God, we're doing this for God, for His glory, not for ourselves, not to benefit ourselves. We're not reading this to gain a bunch of to gain a bunch of knowledge and to be able to let people know all that we know. We should be reading to know God. We should be living our lives to know God, to glorify Him. That's it. So that our reward is great. Our reward holds purpose. Our reward holds something that means something, that can continue on into something, into eternity. Okay, then it starts talking about treasure. Verse 19, do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. So again, focusing on what matters. Investing in things that matter. Living our lives, again, for the Lord. Focused on the Lord. Verse 21 says, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. What do we treasure? Where is our heart? What do we treasure up in our heart? What is our goal? What are we after? What are we thinking about? What are we doing? What are we longing for? What are we hungering and thirsting for? Because remember in the Beatitudes, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Their reward is great. When we seek the Lord, that reward is legit. That peace is legit. What God has, that goodness, that richness, that treasure is something that nothing of this world can compare to. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Verse 24, no one can serve two masters. You cannot serve God and wealth. If we are so concerned with getting money, so that we can do things, so that we can have this freedom, so that we can be seen, so that we can have stuff, so that we can be noticed and whatever the reason is, even if it's in good stuff, I want this money to be able to serve, to be able to give. Are we focused in so much on earning money? Or are we just content in being with the Lord and understanding that He gives everything we have, He has given, that He will provide, that we don't need to worry about anything. We don't need to stress about anything. We don't need to strive for anything. The only thing we need to be doing and in our minds on and fighting for is getting to Jesus, is seeking Him, is knowing Him more. Because from that knowledge, from that awareness, from that discovering more of His heart, we are changed. We are moved. Things are accomplished. We're ushered into more. Just abundance, free, like all of that just naturally happens as we discover more of God's heart, where we are truly transformed. It changes the way we do everything in life, and being found in Him, we're just driven, we're just moved by Him, being led by His Spirit. This goes in then with this and not being worried. So we read from verses 25 all the way down to 32, talking about do not worry. Do not be worried about your life as what you'll eat, what you'll drink, nor for your body as what you'll put in, as what you'll put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing. Let's go down to verse 27. And who of you by being worried can add a single hour to his life? What does worrying do? I'll tell you what it does. It pulls us away from gratefulness, from praises, from lifting up the name of the Lord. When we worry, we are telling God, you're not big enough. You're not strong enough. You can't handle this. You're not going to be able to do this, God. That's what we do. And we're worrying and it's plaguing our minds, or we are dwelling on things of this world down here, when his word tells us to set our minds on things above. We don't have to worry. And in our worry, we are revealing a lack of trust to God, to our provider. We're saying he can't provide for us. We can't worry. We've got to understand that God fights for us. He knows, he sees us, and he cares about every detail in our lives. And he moves things around and shifts things. He stirs things up for us, for what is best for us. If it's best for us to have more things, to have more money, to have better circumstances, then God's going to do it. That's the freedom that we have. God can do whatever, and whatever is necessary in each moment of our lives to bring him the max amount of glory, it's going to happen. It's going to take place. And we can sit back and just be consumed with seeking the Lord, with pursuing him, with knowing him more, where we're not distracted about being worried about anything. Just knowing, having that assurance that God's going to take care of it. God's going to do it. Now, we can't sit back and just wait for him to do it. But in that waiting, in that assurance, in that hope that we have, we could be trusting, seeking the Lord, running after him, knowing him more. And in that discovering him, things happen. And he leads us then into more, into those circumstances that we need to be, into maybe that financial blessing, into those relationships. God will take care of it. We put so much on us. We worry so much thinking that we are in control, thinking that we have a say in things, that we have control over things, that we have this way of making things happen, and we don't. And by worrying, we clearly don't. We absolutely don't. So we have got to focus in and just go after the Lord. Spend more of our time in his word. Spend more of our time meditating on him. Spend more of our time just praising, just crying out to him, telling him how wonderful and good he is, how grateful we are. And in that, through that, he sees that we mean business. He sees that we trust him. And when we trust him, he's going to pour out. He's going to take us in deeper. He's going to take us out and into the depths of the ocean where there's so much, where there's abundance of room and space for the Spirit to come and sweep us up and move us around and carry us on. And his waves of grace are just going to pour out. That's what it is. We've got to get to him. Worrying does nothing. We have nothing in our control. Worrying is not going to snap things into place. Worrying pulls us away from things going into place, from the Lord leading us into place, into all he has called for us, purposed for us. So, okay, let's finish up this chapter with verses 33 and 34. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. We've got to seek him. We've got to keep our eyes on him. We've got to keep our mind on him. We've got to be focused in on his truth, pursuing him with all that we are. Then it says, in that, as we do that, seeking his kingdom and his righteousness first, like before anything. It doesn't say, but seek his kingdom, but seek first his kingdom before anything else, before we let our emotions go crazy, before worry leads us into just tons of time wasted. Before anything, seek him first. And all these things will be added to you. He will work it out. He's got to know that we mean business, though. We have got to show him that, okay, Lord, we're trusting you. We're letting you have your way. You've got free reign in my life and in this situation. He's got to know that we mean business so that he can lead us and show us where we need to go, what we need to do, and how he's going to handle it. He's going to pour out. But if we're too busy worrying, he's held back. He's absolutely held back until we give it to him and we say, okay, Lord, I don't understand. I don't get it, but you have your way. I'm going to trust you and I'm going to praise you through this process. I'm going to be so present with you, seeking you as you do whatever, as you work this thing out. That's where there's power. And all these things will be added to you. Okay, let's jump into Matthew chapter 7. The very first few verses we hit in Luke chapter 6, this whole do not judge so that you will not be judged. Verse 3, why do you look at the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? So all this we hit in Luke chapter 6, talking about just deal with yourself, you know, worry about yourself, focus in, respond to that conviction, you know, meet with the Lord personally so that you can effectively speak into the lives of other people. Don't judge, but focus on, come back into yourself, evaluate yourself, respond to that conviction, listen to the Holy Spirit in your life, and deal with it. Come face to face with it. Keep it real. Verse 5. Continues in on that. You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Let's go down to verse 7. Ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be opened to you. This is the Lord. This is just that assurance again, those promises when the Lord says, seek me with all your heart and you will find me. Seek and you will find. Ask and it will be given to you. Knock and it will be open. God is arms wide open. We know in the New Testament or Old Testament, we read over and over again that he's a righteous God. That those punishments for disobedience, those consequences, they are legit. They are for real. But the second that the people return to him in repentance, the Lord said, return to me, come to me, turn back to me. God was there always, open arms. He says, ask. All you got to do is ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and it will be open to you. We have got to show God that we're serious, that we're taking those steps forward. We want to meet God. We want more of him. And then it's on. He'll pour out. He'll respond. He listens. He sees and he is faithful. Okay. Verse 8, for everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks it will be opened. Let's go down to verse 11. If you then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father who is in heaven give what is good to those who ask him? In everything, therefore, treat people the same way you want them to treat you, for this is the law and the prophets. So we hit this in Luke chapter 6 again. This simple concept yet that holds so much truth, so much just so profound. And how do we want to be treated? How do we want people to respond to us? How do we want to be made, you know, to feel? That's how we need to treat other people. That we need, I want when people are done talking to me, when they walk away, and I know I mentioned this in another video, I want them to walk away knowing more of God, knowing that they're loved by a good, good Father. What are we doing? How are we treating people? How are we truly, genuinely going out of our way to treat people, to love people? Verse 13 and 14, these verses are for real. Enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who enter through it. For the gate is small and the way is narrow that leads to life. And there are few who find it. Guys, this is huge. This is saying point blank that there are going to be a lot more people who will go to hell. A lot more people. It says, wide is the way. For the gate is wide and the way is broad that leads to destruction. And there are many who enter through it. It's just one of those convenience, you know, right here, right now, what people want, what people are going through, how they're living their life. They just, this pursuit of happiness, whatever makes them happy, whatever they want, they're not seeking the Lord. Many, many, many are missing this, are lost, are not hearing, are not accepting the Lord. And it says many, so many more souls will be in hell. It says narrow is the way. Few there be that find it. Because this life, living with God, when we do this thing on purpose, it's not easy. It's not comfort. It's not convenience. It's not this glamorous way to live. Few there be that find it, because there are not many. I'm realizing that there are not many people who are in this thing wholeheartedly, who are in this thing seeking the Lord. There are people who, yes, they read their Bibles. They pray. They go to church. They're involved in a lot of wonderful things. But I am realizing that there are not a lot of people who are in this for real, in this with all that they are, that they are eat, sleeping, breathing, everything, thinking, moving, everything of the Lord. Like they're not all in. We're missing so much. I don't want to miss. I don't want this to go by. I don't want his presence to just go on by and me miss it and not reach out and grab it and not go after more, not see the depths of this, not see the riches in this, not see how far he can take us, how deep he can take us. There are not many. Reading these scriptures, There are not many. Few who find it. Few who find this way. Few are going to make it through those gates to heaven, into eternity with the Lord. We've got to take this seriously. We can't just do as little as we can to get by and to make it, just to barely make it to heaven. We can't have that mentality. We have to be all in. We have to understand the treasure, the rewards that living in a relationship with Jesus gives. What that means, what that is, because we have to understand when we walk away from the Lord, we've got to get, God wants us to see what we're truly walking away from. This is for us. This isn't God saying, I don't want you to have fun and I want to pull you away from everything that a fun life can bring, that would be good for you. And God's not holding out. He's not holding back. He's inviting us into the greatest life to live, the only life to live, the full life to live, this only way. There is one way. He is the way, the truth, and the life, the only way to this narrow gate. Enter through the narrow gate. For the gate is small, and the way is narrow that leads to life, and there are few who find it. I want to be one of those few. I want to take this thing seriously. I want revival to break out, and I want that few to be a few more. Like, we can't stop. We can't just sit back. We can't just try to survive. We can't just try to make it and just do as little as possible. We've got to be all in. We've got to see the richness of this. We got to see that it's so worth it. We got to see that there's so much more. I want that fullness. I want that freedom. I want to know what real life is. That's what I'm choosing. I want to be that few. I choose to be that few, going through that very narrow way that's not always comfortable, that's not always easy, but it's so worth it. So worth it. Verse 15, beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. We've got to have our eyes open. It says, beware of the false prophets. They will come in and they will deceive, and they will speak these things of peace when there is no peace. They will speak these things that are against the word of God, that sound good, that sound right, that sound friendly and loving, but they're not lining up with this word. We have got to know his word. We've got to know his heart. We've got to know who he is so that we will not be deceived. And if this was just a simple thing, clear as day, that everyone will know this deception, know that they're false prophets, then Jesus wouldn't have said beware. He put beware knowing that there will be those who will be deceived. In this warning of false prophets, verse 16 goes into, you will know them by their fruits. We will be known by our fruits. The fruit does not lie. If that good fruit is produced, it means it's from a good tree. It's from goodness. It's from truth. It's based off of what matters, full of purpose, full of life. But if that fruit is, if it's producing bad fruit, it's from a bad tree. It's from a false prophet. It's from deception. It's from a lie, a tactic from the enemy. We've got to see the fruit. What's in this fruit? Is it bringing about truth? Is it speaking encouragement? Is it speaking life? What is it doing? What is it producing? How is it carrying on? Is it lifting up? Is it building up? Or is it crushing down? Is it destroying? Is it putting down? Is it causing hate? Is it causing division? Is it causing tension? We will know. We will know. We will be known by our fruits. Verse 20, so then you will know them by their fruits. Verse 21, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. It's so much more about just doing good. About just being good. We've got to know him personally. He said, I never knew you. Though they did all these things, they prophesied in his name. In his name, they cast out demons. They performed miracles in the name of Jesus. Yet Jesus says, I never knew you. It's about meeting with him personally. It's about that daily pursuit. It's about knowing him. Knowing him, not just talking about him, not just hearing about him at church. It's knowing him. It's meeting with him, having those moments of intimacy where we're still in him, where we know we are familiar with his voice, where we hear his voice, we obey, we follow after, we know him well. It's about knowing him personally. We must know His will so we can live aligned with it. We can live according to it. We're not going to know His will. We're not going to know His truth, what He's calling us to do, if we're not seeking Him, if we're not pursuing Him, if we're not trusting Him. Verse 24, therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and acts on them may be compared to a wise man who built his house on the rock. The rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew, slammed against that house, and yet it did not fall, for it had been founded on the rock. This is what we read about in Luke 6. Everyone who hears the words of the Lord and obeys them, follows after Him, that seeking Him, that they will stand. They will be unshaken. The Lord will be glorified, that the Lord will say, yes, I know you. And we will know the Lord. It's that personal, intimate relationship with the Lord. But then in verse 26, everyone who hears these words of mine and does not act on them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. Again, in Luke 6, we read about this. Those who hear the words and do not listen, they reject the Lord, they turn away, they're disobedient in that, then they will fall. Their house will not stand. It says the rain fell, the floods came, the winds blew, slammed against the house, and it fell. And great was its fall. That leads to destruction. Because the Lord knows what's best, and He gives us these commands. He lays out these instructions for us, knowing that they will lead us into freedom. They will lead us into more righteousness. And through that, and in our pursuit of the Lord, we will stand. Verse 28, when Jesus had finished these words, the crowds were amazed at His teaching, for He was teaching them as one having authority, not as the scribes. This is Jesus speaking with such gentleness, such care and love for everyone coming with that salvation, speaking with authority, that He was different. The way He was speaking was different. The way He lived was different. And He calls us into that, to hear His words and to obey, to follow after Him. Great reward comes in that. From our pursuit of the Lord, we are rewarded. We are blessed. We walk empowered, walk in that freedom, in that life that Jesus came to give, to lay down His life for us to live in. May we just continue pursuing, continue seeking Him, continue trusting Him. So good. So much truth. May we seek the Lord in such boldness, knowing that when we ask, we are given. It is given to us. When we knock, it's going to be open to us. And we know, and we've been talking about it over and over again through the Old Testament, when we seek Him with all of our heart, we will find Him. That's where it's at. That's real living. That's real life. That's beautiful. That's powerful. And it's all because of, in and through Him, through our Savior, through our God. So good. So much truth. Loving this. Thanks so much for joining me on this, walking through His word with me, through His word unveiled. There's so much ahead. So let's keep going after the Lord. See you soon on my next video.